This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We come together as the people of God on the first day of the week to begin the week in praise and thanksgiving to our Lord and King, to begin the week in mutual support of one another as the body of Christ, the church. Today is the fourth Sunday of Lent. It's the season we assess where we are in our walk with Christ. It's the season we prepare our souls to celebrate the joy of Easter. All praise the mighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our opening hymn is "This is the Day." Let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
We affirm the faith we profess with the Apostles' Creed. Let us join in this historic confession of our faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. You may be seated. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us go before the throne of grace in our prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
As forgiven people, let us stand and greet each other with signs of reconciliation and peace.
Jesus is the rock, rock of ages.
us to, or the main thing God tells us to do, is love God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all our strength. And to love our neighbors as ourselves. Well, that's easy to say, but sometimes that's one of the hard things that we have to figure out what to do. How do you actually do that? One of the things that Jesus gives us is something called the golden rule. It's in Matthew 7:12. In everything, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. For this is the law and the prophets. This is kind of the summary, a guideline that we can teach our kids that, you know, if you just think about putting yourself in the other person's place, trying to think about where's the other person coming from? Well, what would you like them to do for you if you were in their situation? Builds empathy, and that's how we build love. It's how it helps us understand the pain and suffering that we see in others. And sometimes we kind of get detached. Sometimes, you know, we're trapped in our own bodies, and we think things from our perspective. But to truly love someone, you put them in their shoes and say, you know, if I was in that situation, how would I want someone to love me? How would I want someone to tell me? The golden rule, something that we try to see things the way that they see them. And the song that I chose goes back to that kind of idea of putting yourself in someone else's shoes. That the resources you've given us may be used to build your kingdom upon this earth. Amen.
Amen. from Isaiah chapter 40, 28 through 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary. In his understanding, no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Looking into the New Testament, we find 1 Corinthians chapters 9, 24 through 27. Do you not know that in all race, all the runners run, but only one gets a prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize.
We have a wonderful song that actually Janice Kirby told me about several years ago. We did it, and then, a couple months ago, Jerry Kirby reminded me, y'all need to sing that one again. So it is, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. And I was looking at, I know there are so many scriptures about God holding us, and here are a few. They come from Isaiah and from Psalms. And if you want to look it up, I love the name of the website, jollynotes.com. Okay. So, first of all, from Isaiah, don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. From Psalms, even if my father and mother abandon me, the Lord will hold me close. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. Yet I still belong to you. You hold my right hand. His hand is there. We just have to grab it.
Thank you.
We are now halfway through Lent. Specifically, we're on day 26 of 47 of going through Lent. We're getting week after next is Palm Sunday, and then the next Sunday, April 9th, is Easter. And our sermon series during Lent has been based on Mark 12:30, where Jesus tells us that the greatest commandment is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so we've been looking at these four aspects: heart, soul, mind, and strength. How do we love with our heart, soul, mind, and strength? We've looked at loving God with all our heart and loving God with all our mind. And today we explore what it means to love the Lord God with all our strength. Of course, last week we had the Wesley Rambers here, and they have a very good message for it. And that was an enjoyable little break from this series. But now we're getting back to it. Now we are physical entities. We live in this physical world. Our bodies are how we engage with the rest of creation. We perceive through our physical senses. We gather information with our eyes, sight, with our ears, the sound, the touch, the fragrance, the taste. And it's how we participate in this creation. We are animals. We're animated. We do stuff. We manipulate the objects around us. We produce sounds. We create art. We build things. You remember Madonna had a song that we're living in a material world. And yeah, we are. It truly is a material world. Now, when I was in college, there were several religious groups on campus, and I was student chaplain assistant. And so we're supposed to help to interact with religious groups between the chapel, the official chapel, and the religious groups. At the time, there were 13 that were listed as Christian groups, and there was a Jewish group. Now, we were going to schedule an event and having the meeting, and was working on this, and one of the Christian groups was not real happy with the Christian Science Organization. They didn't consider them Christians. I knew nothing about Christian Science. But I was looking down the list, and I saw the president of the Christian Science Organization, and I knew the girl. She was a nice girl. Didn't have horns or carry a pitchfork or anything, so I kind of figured, well, okay, I'll just ask her. And so I saw her, right after this, I had this conversation, I went down to the cafeteria, and there she was. So I sat down and I asked her, I see that you're president of the Christian Science Organization. What is it that you actually, what is it you guys believe? And she said, what have you heard? I said, nothing good. She laughed, fortunately. And she said, well, okay, we're having a meeting this week. Why don't you come and talk to one of our practitioners? That's what they call the preachers, the practitioner. So I said, okay. And so I did. I went to the meeting, and I heard what they had to say, and then listened to their beliefs. And it's one of those cases where if you accept their initial premise, it kind of logically follows from there. It makes sense if you accept their initial premise. Their initial premise, however, is something I completely reject. Their basic belief is that this existence that we're in right now isn't real. The idea of illusionary existence. That it's kind of like being in the Matrix. There's a thing that we see around us, but that's not what's really going on. And the idea that kind of life is but a dream. No. That's not. Creation is real. God created us and put us here for a reason. Now, we do know that this world is temporary. Jesus told us that. We know that a new earth is coming. There will be a new heaven and a new earth. We know that when the perfect comes, the imperfect will pass away. And Jesus tells us we don't store your treasures here on earth, but store your treasures in heaven. But it doesn't mean that creation doesn't exist, that creation is unreal, or that it doesn't matter. It does. We are here now. We are in this world. We are engaging in the creation that surrounds us. And Jesus expects us to do our duty as disciples in the here and now, in this world. Part of loving God with all our strength is to be the disciples in this world, but not to simply write it off as a lost cause. Jesus said, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever's dishonest with very little can be dishonest with much. So if you've not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? We're expected, we're required to be the hands and feet of Christ. We are expected to engage in this world, this physical world, as it is. Whether it's permanent or whether it's temporary, it doesn't matter. And God has given each of us gifts and talents to use. He's given us our strength to build his kingdom on earth. We're to use those skills so that his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we are to use our bodies. We are to use our strength that God gave us to be disciples, to bring the message, the good news of the gospel to a world that desperately needs to hear it. Our mind cannot be so tied up in heaven that we're no earthly good. Now, to be clear, our salvation does not come from doing stuff. We can't earn our way to heaven by doing good works. The great reformer Martin Luther, he lived at a time when the Roman Catholic Church was buying and selling indulgences. That was one of his main complaints against the Roman Catholic Church, and even the Roman Catholic Church during the Reformation into the practice. It was the idea that you could buy your way in heaven. If you paid a fee to the church, then you could go and have fun and do whatever you wanted to with your bodies. And one of the reasons that the church was justifying this was the letter of James. Martin Luther hated the letter of James. He said that it needs to be thrown out of the Bible. He really wanted to do that. Like I said, he saw what was going on, and like I said, the Roman Catholic Church, I want to say they got rid of it. However, I was online a few years ago, back when Benedict was the Pope, and someone out of the Vatican, I think it was their publicity department, was saying you could buy some time out of purgatory by signing on to his website.
Oh.
Pope Benedict was not technologically advanced. I don't think it came out from him. I think it was somebody that was doing it on his behalf. But the letter of James, he writes this: "What does it profit, my brethren, if a man says he hath faith but not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is ill-clad and lacking daily food, and one of you says, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving him the needs for his body, what does that profit? So faith by itself, without works, is dead." And I can see where that could lead to the idea of works salvation. I can see where, if you stop right there, it does sound like he's talking about earning our way to heaven through by what we do. But you have to read the rest of what James says. And we have a tendency to read verse by verse. We, you know, one of the things those verse numbers and chapters, they help us find stuff, but sometimes we get in the habit of picking things apart and stopping where we want to stop. There's an old vaudeville routine of where the straight man says to the comic, you know, "Give me a verse from the Bible." And the comic says, "Judas went out and hanged himself." The straight man says, "Well, give me another verse." The comic says, "Go and do likewise."
Okay.
You know, they're not connected. So you have to read what the rest of what James says. He says, he goes on to say, "My works will show you my faith. Faith is completed by works." The works that our bodies do out of love for God are a reflection of our faith, within response to the love that Christ has shown us. If our hearts are truly transformed by Christ, then our actions will reflect that transformation. So what we do with our bodies to engage the world to show God's love is actually showing evidence of the fruits that we have. Look at the parable of the sheep. The sheep and the goats. If you remember that parable, the king, he separates the righteous sheep and puts them on the right side, and the unrighteous goats and puts them on the left. And he commends the sheep for their good works, and he condemns the goats for not doing it. Remember, the sheep and the goats both call the king Lord. They both express faith. The problem is that the sheep responded by feeding the hungry, welcoming the stranger, clothing the naked, visiting the sick, ministering to the prisoner, and the goats just didn't do it. The faith of the sheep bore fruit. The faith of the sheep transformed their actions into loving actions. If you're not responding to the command, love one another as I have loved you, then is Jesus really your Lord? There's a duty to discipleship, and part of that duty is to show God's love through our physical bodies, through our actions, to use the strength that we have to put love in real, practical terms. John Wesley instructed the people called Methodist, do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. So what do we do to love God with all our strength? Well, in the parable of the sheep and the goats, what God is telling us, what God tells the sheep and the goats, whatever you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done to me. We need to love who God loves. We need to treasure who God treasures. And as our loving Father, as our common Father, then that is all of us, all His children. We have, probably the best known verse of the Bible is John 3:16. We all know it by heart. We can all recite it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. I personally like the next verse better. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world might be saved through Him. God's desire is for all of creation to be redeemed. The whole world, everything and everyone in it, so that not one may be lost. Like any loving parent, God wants to see all His children loving together, living together in peace and harmony, helping each other out, celebrating each other's joys, teaching each other's righteousness. God wants everyone to be saved, and so what's precious? So it's by serving others, we are serving God because that's who God loves. This past Wednesday, we had a spring break service project, and I asked kids from the high school, and had a few respond. They were mostly from London, from the London church, and Leffler and Jim Quartz was there as well as Liz was there too, helping out. And what they did was they built a ramp for someone in need. They built a ramp 4 feet wide, turned out 40 feet long, and it had a pitch of 5 degrees. And the slope is gentle enough so that when the time comes, the veteran who lives in that house, his wife is able to push him up the ramp into his house. The love the youth showed using the strength of their young bodies will make a real difference in that veteran's life. His world will not be confined to 1,200 square feet of that house. His wife is continuing to live in life. Loving Christian service to each other in all ways, large and small, for building ramps, to something as simply as writing notes of appreciation fulfills God's command. Obviously, we don't all have the same strength. And obviously, some of us have bodies of athletes. Some of us have parts that don't work. Some of us are pretty rusty at this point. And there is the degradation, of course, that comes from age. I used to be a Philmont Ranger. I used to be able to hike 15, 20 miles a day at 13,000 feet in elevation a month, up and down the Rockies with a 40-pound backpack on my back. I can't do that now. The other day, I strained my back closing the refrigerator door. But our bodies are a gift from God. And to love God with all our strength is to maintain the strength we have in order that we may bear fruit for Christ. Now, obviously, this is something I need to work on. I obviously weigh a whole lot. I spent most of my life being allergic to sweat. Some of the kids at school, they'll chide because my name is the same as the basketball player for the Golden State Warriors, Steph Curry. And so they'll ask, can you have a shot in hoops today? So I'm just kidding, yeah. tell them why one of my standard responses, we can tell the difference between me and Steph Curry. He runs the 100-yard dash in 8.2 seconds, I run in 8.2 on the Richter scale. So maintain strength, and I thank God that I still have the strength to work on a ramp project. I thank God that I still have the strength to deliver Meals on Wheels and the service that I do. And it's something that we're charged to do. Because we don't live for ourselves, we live for those around us. The job of disciples is to be Christ to those outside of our, not just our own self, but be Christ to other people. Paul writes to the church in Corinth, "Do you not know that our bodies are members of Christ? Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God? You are not your own. You were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body." I was watching some videos a couple of days ago. There was this rabbi. And this rabbi, he was discussing the prohibition in Leviticus against tattoos. Expounding on the laws of the Torah. And explained that at the time that the Moses was given this law, the Israelites were surrounded by pagan societies in which tattoos were a form of worship. And, you know, it was typical to get a tattoo to honor Asherah or Baal or some of the other, and to set the people of Israel apart is one of the reasons why God gave the Israelites that law. But he went on to say that even though this is no longer the case, even though that's, you know, we're not surrounded by cultures who tattoo for religious reasons, that our bodies don't belong to us. Our bodies are on loan to us by God. And we're to take care of them. And we're to treat them as that temple that Paul talks about. That we're to keep our bodies clean, to keep it sober, to keep our bodies chaste and healthy. These bodies have been bought with a price. And so we need to be ready to serve whenever or wherever we're needed in order to glorify God. We love God with all our strength when we're always ready to be Christ wherever he calls us to be. Saint Teresa of Avila writes, "Christ has no body now but yours. No hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes through which Christ looks compassionate upon this world. Yours are the feet with which Christ walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which Christ blesses the world." Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the strength that you've given us. Help us to use our bodies to serve you, to be the compassion, to bring your message to a world in desperate need to hear it. Let us be your hands and feet of love to all your children, that they may know the joy of your salvation, now and forevermore. Amen. Our hymn of reflection is "There's Something About That Name." You may remain seated as we prepare to go forth. This big, beautiful, wonderful creation that satisfies all of our needs. We thank you for all the people that you've given to us that we love, that love us and support us. Help us to show the love of Christ and go out there and be your heart, that we may show the love that you have shown us. We thank you for the rains that you've sent to refresh the earth. You know our land needs more. We love to see the blossoming of the flowers of the fields, the colors of which you paint the landscape. Please send more rain that the land may be strong and healthy. We lift up before you those things that are heavy on our heart and minds, the concerns of this world. We pray your healing touch on those whose bodies are hurting, who need to be relieved of pain, and who need to find comfort. We ask that you be with them, that you grant them that strength, that you alleviate that suffering, that they may be strong for you. We pray for doctors and nurses and EMTs and all those who look after our health, who come to help us when we've injured ourselves, who take care of our bodies when we've done things that probably we shouldn't have done. We thank you for the diligence and the care that they show, the compassion that they have in following that command to heal others, the call that you put on their lives. Be with their families, and the time they spend apart for our good, that they may know your peace, that they may know your joy, that you may bless the work of their hands and grant them that satisfaction that comes with living as you have commanded and loving as you have commanded. We pray for those that are on the frontiers of science and research that are constantly trying to find new ways to improve the quality of human life. We thank you for teachers and administrators and professors and researchers that are constantly on that cutting edge of truth, that they may continue to find ways to alleviate human suffering. We thank you for teachers who instruct young minds. We thank you for this period of spring break, this time where the teachers and the administrators and the students have time of rest and refreshment. Let them return tomorrow to their studies with new diligence and new resolve as they complete the last couple of weeks of this semester. Give them that hunger and thirst for your truth, since all truth comes from you. And in that truth, they may see you and love you more. We pray for those who stand between us and the chaos that's out there, our firefighters, our military, our law enforcement. We pray for leadership that is compassionate, that is wise, that loves the people that they're making the decisions for. Grant them wisdom and resolve and courage, that we may be a society where wounds are healed, where economic prosperity enables everyone to enjoy the beauty and bounty of creation. That the walls be torn down between peoples, that relationships be healed, so that we may live together in peace and love. Let mercy and forgiveness and understanding prevail, so that we may see each other as brothers and sisters, that we know that we're not perfect, and giving ourselves license to stumble and fall, but always willing to help pick someone else up and reach out for that when we stumble and fall. We thank you for the example of your Son, Jesus Christ, who set before us a life filled with love and compassion without sin. Help us to follow in his steps more closely every day. Help us to listen to his words and his teachings, that we may be his ambassadors in this world. And mostly we thank you for the gift of salvation of his blood, that he would die for sinners such as us, so that we may be washed clean, so that we may have that second chance to come into your presence and experience the beatitude and the bliss of being with you in that great communion of saints. We pray for the guidance of those that are lost in confusion and chaos, We ask that your guiding light be clarify their minds. Lord, show us the way that we should go. Show us how to be better disciples each and every day. That your kingdom may truly prevail upon this earth. And that the peace and love that flows so greatly in heaven may flow here as well. All this we ask in the name of our great rabbi who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Is there anyone today that has a special joy or celebration they'd like to share, or a concern they'd like the body of Christ to pray over?
Her son was in a very bad motorcycle accident 2 weeks ago now. She's been living up in San Antonio and has been moved to a long-term acute care facility. They've had to put a trach in and still need to breathe for him. He's not responsive, and she's really struggling between his heart and hands, and it's a bad situation. And she needs our prayers.
Mighty God, we pray for this paramedic who serves this community, who's always there to help us. We pray for her and her son who is in this accident. We pray for your healing touch upon him. Continue to heal him. Continue to give wisdom and guidance to the doctors that his body may be made whole. We pray that your comfort and peace be with her as she worries about her son and her prayers for him and the time she's spending with him. We pray that your will be done, that your strength may be there in spirit and in their souls. We ask in your name. Amen.
As we speak for Sarah Harrison, she's having the only senses of a surgeon and a doctor tomorrow. God bless her.
Mighty God, we pray for Sarah and the pain that she's undergoing and the doctor's appointment that's coming up. We thank you for all she does, not only for this church, but for this community in your name. We pray for her and Larry, and we pray for that you grant them peace, that you grant them comfort. We pray that whatever she's doing, that the doctors may find a way to treat it. We lift them up before you and all that you've done through them, these two very faithful disciples. Be with her, grant her calmness of soul, grant her peace in her spirit, and that blessed assurance that you are with her always. We ask in your name. Amen.
Thanksgiving for travel mercies for visitors for spring break and continued prayers as they go back where they have to go, school, work, etc., and for watching over our school kids since they've been traveling over the break and various competitions, and thank you for praying for our one act play. Please keep it up, because we're still going on.
Mighty God, for those that are traveling and for spring break as they return, we thank you for protection that you've given them through this break. Grant them continued watch over them as they return home, as they get ready to return to classes tomorrow. We pray for the time they spent with their families that brought them closer together. We also thank you for our one-act play and the success that they continue to have. We thank you for the talent that you've given these young people. Continue to bless them and give them hearts that will follow and honor you in the talents that they have. Grant them your guidance, your peace, and show them your way so that they may grow up to be men and women of God all the days of their lives. Amen. Yes, Jeff.
We might remind everybody that's in the bulletin a week from Monday, the 27th. We may be back here together.
What Joe's talking about is, as you probably are aware, we need to come up with some ideas to help revitalize and strengthen the mission and ministry of this church. We're having a dinner and a meeting on the 27th back in the Fellowship Hall. We need ideas to help reach out to this community, to continue to bring God's message as we're supposed to, make disciples of all nations, and how we can do it better in our community. So that is 2 weeks from tomorrow, right?
1 week.
1 week from tomorrow. I can count.
The 27th.
The 27th. Also remember that next week is our fourth Sunday, and we'll be having lunch, and of course everyone's welcome to join and participate, and it's always good food, as people always try to bring. I'd also like to extend to those that are listening by radio and watching on the live stream that you're also welcome to come and join us next week for worship, and then followed by luncheon. We'd like to get to know you and to meet you as well. That's all that's immediately coming up. We are 2 weeks from Palm Sunday. That's coming up. We're getting ready for Holy Week and the events. So look for announcements, all of that. Anything else that we need to? Yes?
Bible study tonight.
Oh, yes. Bible study tonight. We're doing the sandwich and salad Bible study. Anyone's welcome to participate. It's at 5 o'clock, and we're doing the "You have heard it said, but I say" verses from the Matthew chapter 5. Then our closing hymn is "Take My Life and Let Me Stand and Sing." May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen.